Friday, October 5th, I'm Paul Joseph Watson. This is Infowars Nightly News, coming up on the show tonight.
Tonight, an invisible war rages in the Mideast as Turkey launches attacks on Syria. Then, need a gun? Press print. The 3D printable gun revolution is now. Plus, parents up in arms over palm scanners at schools. And Ashley Jessica calls for an opt-out campaign after being groped by the TSA. That's up next on the InfoWars Nightly News.
Top story tonight, Turkey lied about Syria taking responsibility for attack. This is Infowars.com. Turkey lied to the United Nations when it claimed that Syria had apologized and taken responsibility for the mortar attack, which led to a de facto declaration of war, increasing the likelihood that the shelling was actually carried out by Turkish-backed FSA rebels. So basically, as you know, what happened is a mortar shell landed in Turkey a couple of days ago, killed five people in a residential area. Turkey instantly blamed Syria, had their parliament rubber stamp military attacks inside Syria, and then told the UN that Syria had apologized and accepted responsibility for the incident, which of course led to the UN, Hillary Clinton, etc., roundly condemning Syria, increasing the pressure on Assad. And the international media ran with this Syria admits responsibility hoax and is still running with it, despite the fact that Syria's UN representative, Bashar al-Jafri, came out publicly and said Syria did not apologize and did not accept responsibility for the attack. And you can watch the video of him saying that in this article. So it appears as if this hoax of Syria admitting that they were behind the attack when no such thing happened is really starting to become part of the official narrative behind this series of events. And it served to kind of dampen down the growing evidence, which was reported on by German news station ZDF, that it was actually the Turkish-backed FSA rebels that were responsible for the initial mortar attack, which has only benefited them, in fact, because it's justified Turkey's aggressive response in opening up this 10-kilometer corridor of bombing and strafing, which has created a path for those very rebels to go back and forth between Syria and Turkey, which of course is where most of them are based. And I mean, you've got to love Turkey green lighting these military strikes inside Syria and then claiming they're not at war with Syria because they've been attacking them for the past 3 days, as I said, 10 kilometers deep inside Syria. You know, they've killed numerous Syrian army soldiers. For months, they've been recruiting, sheltering, training, arming, funding these militants to carry out terrorist attacks inside Syria. They've done all this, but still claim we're not at war with Syria. So it looks like the Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan is taking a leaf out of the Mars attacks book of diplomacy. You know, don't run where your friends while they're attacking and strafing inside Syria, while simultaneously declaring we're not at war with anyone. So even though Erdogan basically went straight to Washington after this mortar incident, begged the Obama administration to impose a US Air Force-led no-fly zone over Syria, which of course is a euphemism for bombardment and bloodshed, as we saw with Libya. Again, Turkey's not at war with Syria. Just believe that Orwellian hoax, which the international media has, because they've regurgitated the hoax that Turkey had accepted, that Syria had accepted responsibility. Completely not true. They never did any such thing. And so, you know, it would be like if you walked up to somebody on the street, told them you hated their guts, punched them in the face, and then smiled and said, I don't want to fight with you. That's seemingly the role that Turkey has taken in this Mars attack style diplomacy. And of course, in doing so, they're being completely backed by the UN, by NATO, by Hillary Clinton, by all of them. So it's the next stage in ratcheting up the pressure on Syria as this Brookings Institution plan for neocon regime change moves ever closer. Staying with geopolitical news now, Zero Hedge reports naval update T-minus 1 week until Arabian Sea destination reached. The news surrounding the Middle East, particularly Iran and Syria, may come and go in waves, but for the most part, it is loud political grandstanding, jawboning, and largely noise. Or rather, it will be noise until these two catalytic events occur. The third U.S. aircraft carrier, CVN-74 Stennis, and the second big-deck amphibious warship, LHA Peleliu, both dispatched as of several weeks ago with a destination for the 5th U.S. Fleet headquartered in Bahrain, reached their target. This is in 1 week's time from today. The Arabian Sea, located by the Straits of Hormuz and next to Iran. As the following naval update from Stratfor shows, which you can see on the screen, both are now within a week of reaching their destination, conveniently so, with at least 2 weeks to go until the presidential election. So basically, it's widely accepted that the United States only launches a new war when there are three aircraft carriers in place in whatever region in which they wish to engage in that conflict. So in 1 week's time, that's precisely the situation we're going to have around the Arabian Sea there, right next to Iran. So given Turkey's declaration of war on Syria and their demand for a no-fly zone, which we just talked about, we really have to be on the lookout for this. Because obviously it looks as if Iran has been delayed until spring 2013, but that doesn't mean there couldn't be an incident in the region over the next few weeks. Something, you know, in the context of what the neocon think tanker and lobbyist, which we featured last week, Patrick Clawson, wished out loud for, a false flag provocation involving Iran. And remember that an incident involving Iran is precisely what ABC News predicted last week could be the October surprise that hands either Obama or Romney the presidency. Now, of course, you know, there's not a cigarette's paper difference between the two of them when it comes to backing up the US military-industrial complex. But that's not to say there aren't different groups of power within that two-party system jockeying for position and power. And the ABC News piece was pretty certain that there'd be an October surprise involving Iran or a false flag on US interests before the election. So 1 week from now, there's going to be three U.S. aircraft carriers stationed right outside Iran with just 3 weeks to go until the U.S. presidential election. So it seems pretty clear that if anything's going to happen, it's going to happen in that time slot. And in a similar vein, just a different position on the globe, moving on now to this Business Insider story, two carrier groups are now operating in the China Sea. The USS George Washington and the USS John C. Stennis aircraft carrier strike groups, a flotilla of five ships and more than 10,000 Navy personnel, are now operating in the conflict-ridden South China Sea. The news was announced by the Navy a few days ago, but it is now making the rounds in Asian media outlets and generating as much speculation as it is concern. So, three ships around Iran, two aircraft carriers now in the South China Sea. So this is basically a warning to China not to escalate its posturing in the island dispute. If you saw a third aircraft carrier, as we just discussed, then the alarm bell would really start ringing. But it's about reassuring Japan, of course, that the US will follow through on its treaty obligations while also serving as a hands-off message to China. Because we covered, of course, a couple of weeks ago, a lot of the protests in China against Japan's claim of ownership over these disputed islands were created by the Chinese government itself. That's the only reason the protests were allowed to happen. Legitimate, genuine demonstrations in China are routinely crushed by the authorities. We just saw last week the villagers complaining about being kicked off their land. They steamrolled over one guy, crushed him to death. So if it's a genuine protest in China, it's certainly not going to be even reported on by the state media, never mind encouraged by the state itself, which is exactly what we saw with these anti-Japanese protests just a couple of weeks ago. So it's America's response to China's saber-rattling, basically. That's why there are two large aircraft carriers now operating in the South China Sea. Remember the story a couple of weeks back about how China was preparing to respond to the US becoming involved in the conflict. That's actually what a top PLA admiral said. They were getting ready for America to embroil itself in the conflict. So it looks like this one's going to bubble under the surface, at least for the time being, while the focus remains on the Middle East, but the tension remains high. Moving on to financial news, Tea Party Congressman Allen West, Jack Welch is right on jobs report manipulation theory. So we had the US unemployment figures out today, and they basically contradicted the expected rise to 8.2%, came out at 7.8%, dropped significantly, much to everybody's surprise. But across the board, financial analysts and others have come out and accused the Obama administration of manipulating the figures as an election stunt. And Florida Rep. Allen West, a Republican running for re-election, said that he agrees with former GE CEO Jack Welch's theory that President Barack Obama is skewing the non-farm payroll report. This is what he said. I agree with the former GE CEO Jack Welch. Chicago-style politics is at work here. Somehow by manipulation of data, we're all of a sudden below 8% unemployment a month from the presidential election. This is Orwellian, to say the least, he said, and representative of Saul Alinsky tactics from the book Rules for Radicals, a must-read for all those who want to know how the left strategize. So basically, this Republican Tea Party representative is agreeing with the GE CEO, Jack Welch, who in a tweet said, quote, unbelievable jobs numbers, these guys will do anything, can't debate, so change the numbers. So they're both accusing the Obama administration of deliberately manipulating the jobs figures just a month before the presidential election. But if you look at the actual figures, the number of unemployed and underemployed Americans has actually risen by 400,000 since last month. So most of these new jobs that the Obama administration is including in this 7.8% figure, or the drop in the figure, are part-time or temporary jobs. So they're certainly not indicative of an economic recovery. So are they massaging the numbers? Well, yes, they always massage the numbers. They don't even count the Americans who have given up completely on looking for work. They're not even included in the figures. So the unemployment figure is false to begin with. It always has been. Big Brother news now. Some parents decry new Carroll School's palm scanner. This is out of the Baltimore Sun. Instead of paying for their lunches with crumpled dollar bills, again, dirty money there, casting aspersions on money, students in Carroll County schools are having their palms scanned in a new checkout system, raising concerns from some parents that their children's privacy is being violated. The county is one of the first localities in Maryland to use the palm secure system, in which children from kindergarten to 12th grade place their hands on an infrared scanner. It identifies unique palm and vein patterns and converts the image into an encrypted numeric algorithm that records a sale. So the school claimed that it had an opt-out process for this palm scanning to buy school lunches for the kids there. But they actually took the palm prints of the kids before the parents even knew anything about it. And this is what the Electronic Privacy Information Center had to say. Quote, we're talking about elementary school students, and that type of technology can make children less inclined to the rights of privacy. Imagine being tracked from age 8 to 16 and then a university continues to use it, it becomes old hat and makes them less inclined to recognize privacy threats. So yeah, that's exactly what it is. As we discussed before, it's prisoner training. You know, how great is the leap between scanning your palm to buy a school lunch to scanning a chip in your arm to buy food, a fast food restaurant or anywhere? Is a very small leap to make, and the fact that all the kids are being indoctrinated with this, not to mention all the RFID tags and all the other tracking technology that they have to wear in school, it's complete prisoner training. It's preparing them for Big Brother in the outside world. And it's at a time when, you know, states can barely afford to hire teachers, and yet they're willing to spend $300,000 to install this fancy palm scanner. So, you know, no money for the teachers, plenty of money to get your kids enrolled in the slave system. And as I say every week on this show, basically, another perfect reason to homeschool your kids. Printable gun revolution moving forward despite corporate Second Amendment fears. This is out of Infowars.com. The company that rented out the 3D printer that was to be used in the testing and design phase of a group's revolutionary gun manufacturing concept took their equipment back last week. However, persistent Cody Wilson explains he and his organization aren't deterred in their efforts to bring the idea to fruition. And basically, this is about this nationwide project to use this amazing new 3D printing technology where you can physically print out real three-dimensional parts. And they were using it to manufacture perfectly legal firearms for personal use. No commercial licenses needed, no license needed for the gun or the parts. And the company that leased out the machines, Stratasys Incorporated, just pulled the plug on the whole thing. They completely freaked out, claiming that it was in some way illegal, when in fact, as the individual involved in this story pointed out to Infowars, it's completely and perfectly lawful. So for more on this story, let's go to John Bowne with this special report.
Second-year UT law student Cody Wilson has devised a plan to print guns from a three-dimensional printer. Now, this is a regular printer, and this is a regular sheet of paper, and this is a picture of a gun, but there's really no difference. Now, whether or not these guns will be classified as Title I or Title II remains to be seen, but the main point here is the little man has his freedom intact. Our Second Amendment rights may be simply printed from a printer. And that scares the pants off of the tyrannical government.
People say, oh, you know, now everyone can have a gun. Everyone can already have a gun. This is America. I mean, you know, and wiki weapons aren't anytime soon going to be the real threat to human civilization.
Defense Distributed has developed two prototypes. These are wiki weapons A and B. Wiki weapon A is what we're calling our teaching prototype. It's designed to have no moving parts and be completely electronic in its action. We'll have a solenoid and electronic add-ons after it's been printed. And so in effect, it's only the beta for the fully realized vision that we're talking about. Wiki Weapon B is the trickier animal. Wiki Weapon B is conceived to have a fully mechanical action.
The electronic versus the mechanical operation of a trigger mechanism is one that actually evolved from the Olympics. Olympic level shooters were looking for a quicker lock time, and the only way to really ensure an instantaneous lock time is to eliminate the mechanical components. So what was done is they created an electric ignition system.
I called San Antonio later, and you know, they didn't know. This guy was like, look, just to be safe, man, it's probably Title II, it's probably an AOW, get a license, it's not that hard. And I said, okay, yeah, but you know, fine. I mean, that's the answer I needed. So I know I've got to hide behind a license because some prosecutor's going to have way too much discretion if I do this without one.
We approached the local ATF office for comment. A representative from the Washington, D.C. Bureau responded with this email. The term any other weapon means any weapon or device capable of being concealed on the person from which a shot can be discharged through the energy of an explosive. A pistol or revolver having a barrel with a smooth bore designed or redesigned to fire a fixed shotgun shell. Weapons with combination shotgun and rifle barrels 12 inches or more, less than 18 inches in length, from which only a single discharge can be made from either barrel without manual reloading. The 3D printer company, Stratasys, had no comment, but referred us to the statement they had made to Defense Distributed. Based upon your lack of a license and your public statements regarding your intentions in using our printer, Stratasys disagrees with your opinion. It is the policy of Stratasys not to knowingly allow its printers to be used for illegal purposes. According to recently acquired documents, Stratasys is working with Remington Arms and Knights Armament Company that is in bed with DARPA, along with the Defense Department. Stratasys was so proud of their work with Detroit Gunworks after building a prototype upper and lower receiver of a .308 caliber pistol that they tweeted about it.
Biggest concern is their lack of control, and that's just the way it is. They want to be able to say when we can, how we can, and where we can, and that's not their place. And they're looking for every excuse under the sun, and in this case, they're looking and actually creating myths and fables in order for the American populace to believe, to legitimize their actions towards doing this to this young inventive man who's actually taking a brilliant machine, put it to brilliant use.
The first order goal is to do what we said we wanted to do at the very beginning, which is simply to see if this works, this being, you know, the wiki weapons, taking other people's designs, and if there are candidate files that actually hold up to some standard of safety, work one time, even if it's still kind of dangerous, look, you, we believe you're responsible enough to know that it's dangerous, and we believe it's, we're responsible enough as a society to share these things and collaborate and perfect these things as technology improves.
In 1993, the Brady Handgun Violence Prevention Act was signed into law, regulating potential gun owners by means of a background check. The snowballing war against our Second Amendment rights continued as the United Nations drew up the Global Arms Trade Treaty that attempted to create a global registry of private ownership of firearms. This treaty would mandate creation of a national collection agency for the confiscation of small arms. Meanwhile, the Obama administration was walking thousands of small arms across the border into the hands of Mexican drug gangs in a failed attempt to demonize the Second Amendment.
Is the printable gun revolution moving forward, or does Big Brother already have a stranglehold on the technology? I'm John Bowne for Infowars Nightly News.
So the key takeaway from that, as John explained in his report, is the fact that Stratasys is actually working with the military to make traceable guns, but the little guy who tries to make them for his own personal use, he's not allowed to do it. They came in and seized the actual machines. So again, you know, people are being treated with suspicion for buying two boxes of ammo at their local gun store while the DHS arms itself to the teeth with, you know, 1.4 billion bullets. So again, it's a double standard. It's one for them, one for us, and it always seems to be skewed against the Second Amendment. Quote of the day now on InfoWars Nightly News, this comes from Robert Southey. All deception in the course of life is indeed nothing but a lie, reduced to practice and falsehood passing from words into things. And that's, you know, pretty much what we try to do here at InfoWars, try to cut through the deception and uncover the truth as best we can. And to help us do that, we've just announced today coming up is the 2012 InfoWars Money Bomb. It's going to take place October 18th and 19th, so just in a couple of weeks' time. And, you know, we don't get banker bailout money like MSNBC. We don't get a $1 million check from George Soros like Media Matters. We don't have massive corporate sponsors who tell us what to say and do, like the US military industrial complex controlled media. We're beholden to no one but the truth. That's what we try to do, try to uncover the truth on a daily basis. And we need your support to continue growing. I mean, just look how much we've grown over the past couple of years. All the new reporters, we're really starting to break through the mainstream media paradigm, reaching more people every day. And you can see the money that you gave on the last couple of InfoWars money bombs has gone directly back into the operation. Just a ton of excellent new reporters hired, new projects on the horizon, new studios being built. Of course, we've got reporters on location doing interviews, doing man on the street. None of that would have been possible without your support. So you can go to Infowars.com today. We've got the story up there by Kurt Nimmo, and we'll be sure to give you more information on the Infowars Money Bomb, which is coming up later this month, October 18th and 19th. We'll be right back with Ashley Jessica to talk about the exciting new TSA opt-out and film campaign. Stay tuned. We're back on InfoWars Nightly News, and I'm delighted to be joined by our guest, Ashley Jessica, a young woman who decided to turn lemons into lemonade by using her bad experience at the hands of the TSA to collaborate with InfoWars in launching our exciting new opt-out and film campaign, which is set to take place this Thanksgiving. And she has an MA in clinical psychology and is currently pursuing her PhD. Ashley, welcome to the show.
Hi, Paul. Thank you for having me.
So briefly, just describe your experience with the TSA and how it spurred your idea for this campaign.
Well, just in a nutshell, I was coming back from Norfolk, Virginia Airport, and I was with my mom and younger brother, and we all opted out of the body scanner, and we were told that we would have to be subjected to a pat down for doing so. The TSA agent who told us that then went and called what looked to me to be two of the most intimidating looking TSA agents there to give us pat downs. So I was taken off to one side and my brother was taken off to another side. The TSA agent who gave me this pat down ordered me to turn around and separate my legs and pretty much treated me like a prisoner. At that point, I turned around and asked her to describe the procedure to me. And she told me that she was going to be touching my private parts with the backs of her hands. I turned back around and I was like, "You're going to be touching my what now?" And I recall telling her that I would give her permission to pat me down, but not to touch my private areas. And at that point, she called what she said was a TSA supervisor and told her that I was giving her a hard time. And I told this TSA agent that she had told me that she was going to be touching my private parts, which is illegal. And this agent assured me that she would stand there and watch and make sure everything was okay. So we proceeded with the pat down. And when she got to my behind, she pressed on it really hard. And I jumped forward. And she told me that I wasn't allowed to move during the pat down. And then she went and did it again, the exact same thing. And I turned around and I was like, "What are you doing?" And she said she was going to have to do it over and over again until I didn't flinch. And she told me that she said she was going to be touching my private parts with the backs of her hands. At this point, I refused to continue with the pat down. I was very upset, on the verge of tears, to be honest. And they told me that if I didn't continue, that I was not going to be permitted to fly that day. And they told me that I wasn't flying because I was refusing. And they told my mom that I was not going to be flying that day.
And then at that point, I believe your brother stepped in and started recording the whole procedure. Okay. A different TSA agent came in and started conducting a pat down that was noticeably less invasive than the first one. Isn't that the case?
Yes, exactly what happened. That first TSA agent actually patted down my mom on film, and even gave her a less invasive pat down than she had given me. And then I was patted down by another TSA agent who gave me the most polite pat down ever. My brother likened it to a demonstrational video, pretty much. Described everything she was going to do, didn't come near my private parts. It was just completely different than the first pat down that I had gotten off film.
Which shows that they're a lot more respectful once they know they're being filmed. But wasn't it the case that the TSA agent who conducted the first pat down then started getting angry about the fact your brother was filming the whole thing, even though it says on the TSA website that anybody can do that, and she actually threatened to take you to court?
She did, yeah.
You weren't even filming her.
Right after, and said that legally we're not allowed to film her. She tried to intimidate him into deleting it, but I think he did a really great job of just staying calm in spite of all that harassment and continuing to film, and letting her know that we have the right to film and that we were going to continue to do so.
And you can see the video of all this on my YouTube channel, which is Prison Planet Live. So how did this kind of snowball into the idea for the campaign that you then approached Infowars with, which is of course opt out and film? How did that experience translate into your idea for this campaign?
Well, I realized through this experience that, like you said, they are a lot more respectful when they know they're being videoed. So I thought that this campaign is a great opportunity for us to let the TSA know that we're not going to allow them to violate our rights anymore and humiliate us and degrade us. And by filming, opting out of the invasive TSA procedures, that's a way for us to protect our rights and also hold the TSA accountable for the way that they respond to us opting out.
And that's important because, as we saw with the 2010 opt-out campaign, which generated a lot of news headlines, the TSA was forced to respond to it by basically shutting down most of the scanners in major airports. We had numerous reports flooding in. There was news reports about it. Our own Infowars reporters experienced it. They roped off and shut down the body scanners to prevent people from having the ability to opt out, which highlighted the fact that these body scanners have got nothing whatsoever to do with security, because they made a political decision on that one day not to employ them, simply to avoid the PR embarrassment of the whole opt-out campaign. So, I mean, that's the goal really, isn't it? Shining a light on the TSA, because when you do so, they're more likely to treat you like a normal human being with some ounce of dignity. And if we can get that culture ingrained into people who are traveling, especially on a regular basis, because the regular travelers are the ones that really loathe the TSA. They had that poll where 54% of travelers in general were happy with the TSA. If you then looked at the actual regular travelers, the frequent travelers, it was the complete opposite, because they're used to it. They have to go through it again and again. They get treated like farmyard animals, basically, and people are sick of it. So it's about shining a light on the actions of the TSA to try and get them to change their behavior. And of course, with the Republicans making noises about defunding the TSA, it could be the start of the end, especially with airports now, in many places, replacing them with private screeners. So just go over the details of the opt-out and film campaign for us. What's it all about? When's it going to take place? How can people get involved?
Sure. So the campaign is taking place November 19th to 26th. So basically, we're just encouraging everybody to opt out of all of the TSA's invasive security procedures, including both types of scanners. Despite what the TSA says, both types of scanners are associated with significant health risks, and opting out of all of the other invasive procedures, such as drink testing at the gate, thumb scanning, eye scanning, freezing, having the TSA order you to freeze on command, opting out of all of those and filming what happens. And to get more information about the campaign, you can go to infowars.com/opt-out. You can join the Facebook group and also follow me on Twitter at Ashley Jessica. And
And just on the wider point, you mentioned the chat downs, the drinks being tested after people have already passed through security and purchased them in the airport, the all-stop policy where for no reason the TSA orders everyone to freeze in place like statues. We saw that story last week out of Sky Harbor Airport in Phoenix, which went viral, caused a lot of consternation amongst the TSA. I mean, Ashley, you've studied psychology. I mean, what are they trying to achieve with all these bizarre policies?
It seems to me that they're trying to assert their dominance, show everybody that they're in charge, and to essentially teach people that if they don't comply, that they will be punished for not doing so. It's like they want everyone to check their rights and freedoms at the door, you know, when they come in contact with the TSA.
Well, yeah, it's about obedience training, isn't it? And the cop-out is, well, just don't fly. But then, of course, we've got the problem of the TSA now at political events. They were at a Mitt Romney event, a Paul Ryan event. They were at the DNC. They were at the RNC. They're on highways. They're in subways. They're at ferry terminals. They're even at school prom nights. I mean, there were stories last year about that. So it's not about avoiding your right as a human being of mobility, the right to travel. You can't just sacrifice that to avoid these people, because they're going to be amongst our everyday lives. You know, they're going to be in the mall eventually. There was even talk about them being at movie theaters after the Batman shooting. So if we don't say no and put a stop to it now, put a stop to being treated like farmyard animals at the hands of these minimum wage morons, which of course are all under the auspices of the Department of Homeland Security, which routinely characterizes innocent Americans as terrorists, anybody who has political beliefs that are not mainstream as terrorists, then where is it going to end? I mean, it's just going to run rampant. So that's why in the spirit of the 2010 opt-out campaign, we're launching the 2012 opt-out and film campaign, which is November 19 to 26 during Thanksgiving week. So Ashley, any final closing comments?
I just really hope that everyone will get involved with this campaign. I think it's just so important that we reassert our rights and let the TSA know that if they are going to continue to humiliate us, try to degrade us and control us that the world will see, because we will be filming them.
Okay, Ashley, Jessica, we appreciate the time, and I'm sure we'll be hearing from you again the closer we move towards Thanksgiving. Thanks a lot.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And so now this cartoon that we found really illustrates what the TSA is trying to do with its obedience training and punishing any sheep who dares to resist the complete evisceration of their dignity. Now we're going to throw to Melissa Melton and Aaron Dykes in studio to cover their recent encounters with Whole Foods management and the latest in the unraveling GMO scandal. Stay tuned.
Hello? This is Linda West with a special report for Infowars.com. A new DVD has come out by GMO expert and scholar Geoffrey Smith. It's entitled Genetic Roulette. It exposes the shockingly unbelievable connection between the proliferation of GMOs by huge agri-corporations and the huge increase in disease in America.
Things we're seeing today aren't normal. We didn't see them 30 years ago or 50 years ago.
Illnesses that weren't epidemic before are now epidemic.
With this new comprehensive information, we can finally solve the mystery between the rising disease, cancer, allergies, Alzheimer's, premature aging, and even autism.
I'm concerned about all the health issues that I'm seeing. But the one that I am most alarmed about is autistic spectrum, which is literally skyrocketed.
We can't say for sure that GMOs have anything to do with autism, but we can't say for sure that it doesn't. In fact, there's been an increase in autism since GMOs were introduced, and animals that eat GMOs, both in laboratory and in livestock situations, have shown some telltale signs that some practitioners say are linked with autism.
Geoffrey Smith has done the scientific research that finally reveals the truth about GMOs that big agri-corps and the government has tried so hard to cover up. This food conspiracy is making them billionaires and us sick.
He said he lost about 90% of his miniature steers. What the problem was is, I guess he said that they weren't able to process the food correctly and they would bloat up and die from it.
Now that we have the real information, we can make changes. Now we know exactly why disease is on the rise, surgeries are on the rise, and so many small minds are being stolen from autism. I know today we all have a lot on our plate. But what's on our plate today is killing us. This is Linda West wishing your family a happy and healthy future.
Welcome back to the InfoWars Nightly News. We have a very special report we're about to cover for you after we hit up some even more important news fresh from the headlines. Paul Joseph Watson has written on FEMA's plan to mobilize for mass fatality planning. This is a new bill that has passed through Congress. It's H.R. 6566, better known as the Mass Fatality Planning and Religious Considerations Act. And this just piggybacks off of mountains of police state and contagion preparations, all leading towards the predicted and planned for economic collapse, where they're going to contain society. There's likely to be man-made disasters, natural disasters, terror attacks, bioplagues. It could be almost anything, but they're prepared for it. Now, this story is nothing new. It's a continuation of the stuff that Alex Jones and Jesse Ventura covered in the police state episode of the conspiracy theory series you've seen on True TV that hopefully is coming back to air very soon. That particular episode was heavily censored, including literally deleted from people's DVR boxes. Why? Because they don't want the public to know that the continuity of government system is prepared to contain them, to control their lives, to put them into FEMA centers and other prepared mass emergency centers. This bill is just another factual bill on top of other existing infrastructure for the control of society, such as H.R. 645, which established emergency centers, better known as FEMA camps, holiday centers, fun places to go, as well as H.R. 646, which covered preparations for civil unrest. And we see more and more Homeland Security just trying to control the entire United States society through its apparatus, integrating all the continuity of government preparations. Now, we covered back in 2009 the Department of Cemeteries from the state of New York that they sent to cemeteries in New York City, telling them to prepare for mass fatalities, pandemic situations. At the time, they were really hyping the H1N1 flu and other flu pandemics, telling local coroners and cemeteries, you name it, to be prepared for mass casualties. You've seen the footage of mass graves, plastic coffin liners, and I've read through a lot of the documents. Homeland Security has its own division named after the military installation, DMORT, in other words, the mortuary. Homeland Security has that same acronym used in its plans under continuity of government. There are various things that have leaked publicly. Most of it remains classified. You can read some of the old coverage in plans for mass graves confirmed, government surveying cemetery readiness for flu outbreak. But at any rate, it's only going to add to fears of what the government is planning to do should this economic crisis go hog wild, and should people be looking at any cost for ways to survive in this society. Anyway, we will turn now to an update on what has been a long trend of eugenicists trying to socially engineer. They're no longer content with just pushing our buttons through mass media stimulation, through control of the propaganda. More and more, they want to use actual chemical controls on human beings. Melissa Melton, tell us more about this issue and the story you wrote.
Well, as many of our viewers are well aware, scientists, think tanks, and the mainstream media are openly calling now for geoengineering, that is the spraying of barium salts and aluminum into our atmosphere to supposedly cool the earth, when in reality, all it actually does is make people sick and kill plants. But they want to do this as a way to combat man-made global warming. However, one professor thinks that geoengineering is too risky for the environment, so instead he's proposing that we geoengineer humans. Now, Matthew Lau, the director of the master's program in bioethics at New York University, actually wrote a paper entitled Handmade Humans May Hold the Key to Saving the World. And he claims that we should give people tax incentives and free health care in exchange for their willing voluntary participation in these biomedical engineering programs. And in his paper, he put forth such ideas as making people pharmaceutically intolerant to meat, giving women cognitive enhancements so they won't want to get pregnant anymore, and parents actually giving their children hormones to stunt their growth. And he even mentioned a policy where people would have to decide whether or not they want one large child, two medium-sized children, or three small children. And now I know it sounds like I'm discussing the rantings of a insane lunatic, but I'm actually talking about a bioethics professor at a national, well-recognized university, and he's using this idea of man-made global warming, which a concept that was proven a fraud back during 2009 when the ClimateGate scandal broke, and falsified data came to light to thinly veil basically another eugenics program, and it just proves that these people are never going to stop. They're never going to quit. And I think it's particularly sick at a time when we're in a global economic depression. They're going to sell people on the idea of becoming willing science experiments by giving them tax incentives and free health care. I mean, it's sick, it's disturbed, and it's not very ethical, Mr. Bioethics. Back to you, Aaron.
Melissa, I just want to add to that because it is all about eugenics. I don't know if you've noticed, but the bioethicist label is something that these university professors use to push eugenics. These are the same people who called for putting lithium in the water for population control. These are the same terms, bioethicists, the people who say you can kill an infant up to age 3 in the name of saving the earth and controlling the family and all these other control mechanisms. It's always about control. And I've traced all this eugenic stuff, especially back through the Darwin and Huxley families. And if you really look at where Julian Huxley, the first head of UNESCO, and his brother Aldous Huxley came out of, both physically from their family and genetics, but also philosophically through their roots, it comes from their grandfather, T.H. Huxley, who believed in a very particular, very defined form of ethics. His form of ethics were that superior people, the transhumanists, they had already found themselves to be the geniuses they thought they were in their own minds under the but they believed they had the ethical right to replace lesser human beings. And so really this modern day bioethics push, I found any my research is a very much a continuation from eugenics. It's just frightening. You've seen the Rockefeller Foundation trying to control the entire cycle of life. They talked about chemical control of the human at the genetic level back in the 1920s.
I did read that. Well, if they're not going to kill children up to age 3, they'll just give them hormones to make them super tiny, and then we can all fit into our Agenda 21 controlled 220 square foot apartments better. So.
Yeah, but the takeaway message is that humanity's trash and they deserve
We're
to control our lives.
We're causing the earth to die, so we need to do something about it.
And I've got another article on that topic, too. The renewable insanity of Monsanto, of Bill Gates, of the Rockefeller Foundation, and of Craig Venter, who's had a lot to do with the mapping of the human genome. But you see, again, every time they have science and technological developments, they don't use them to empower humanity. They use them to control humanity more and more. So we see this report from Cassandra Anderson, one of our main contributors here at Infowars.com, and she's talking about this new bioalgae movement where they want to replace, they say, up to 17% of U.S. oil imports by using genetically engineered algae that would take a landmass the size of North Dakota and constant fresh water to supply the growth of this algae. In fact, they calculate it would take 350 gallons of water to produce 1 gallon of algae oil. That does not sound sustainable. In fact, they further calculated it would be something on the order of 25% of the entire water supply used for all U.S. land crop irrigation. And that's just crazy. And it's all going through Craig Venter and this Sapphire Energy Company, which Exxon, a Rockefeller spinoff company back from the Standard Oil days, has pumped hundreds of millions of dollars into. It comes out of Bill Gates and Rockefeller Foundation money and other related entities, all kind of branded under the Obama sustainable push. And it's just crazy. They want to take over another potential source of energy. Yes, very inventive. Could some of these things have answers for humanity? Maybe, but they're going to push us on it. Push it on us in the name of green movements, while it's really another mechanism for control. They've obviously lined up the investment so that they alone will profit from it. And meanwhile, it takes a lot of the existing resources away from other people who need them. Just, it's almost exactly like the corn ethanol movement, where instead of using cropland, whether it's corn or some other crop, to grow food people can eat, they're growing it for fuel, taking away from the other land they would have otherwise used to grow. And that has genocidal proportions. It very much ties into that larger eugenics agenda where they think humanity is worthless, where they think they have a right to tell you what's best for your life. That's Bill Gates, that's Rockefeller to a T. And we're going to splinter off into something that doesn't deal directly with these people, but of course we know Rockefeller and Bill Gates are very tied to Monsanto, very tied to the push globally for genetically modified foods. And that really has come back home to roost, because 90% plus of all corn products in the entire globe, or at least in the United States, come from genetically modified sources. The same goes for soy, for cottonseed, and canola oil, among other crops. And these are some of the most common derivatives. They're put in all kinds of processed foods. You can find them in everything. And we found in a special investigation we did this week, Alex helped with the research, so did Rob Dew and others in the crew, we found that Whole Foods are admittedly selling genetically modified foods. There was a big covert expose video put up by the Organic Spies last week, which caught even more attention because it was pulled down on YouTube and censored. But they talked to Whole Foods employees, they investigated the political links, and so did we. And we found that many of the Whole Foods executives, the so-called self-appointed organic elites, have been meeting fairly secretly with the head of the USDA, that's Tom Vilsack, appointed by Obama, have been meeting with Monsanto and the other big ag companies, and there's kind of backroom deals going on where real organic producers, real organic consumers are being deceived, being lied to, being targeted through truly falsely advertising campaigns so that they get them to buy these products when they're not even organic. Melissa, why don't you talk a little bit about this report, and then we'll go right into that special video.
Well, we actually just tried to go down to several Whole Foods grocery stores here in Austin and just talk to people, see what they knew about genetically modified food, and if they realized that Whole Foods grocery stores are actually selling unlabeled genetically modified foods on the shelves openly and admitting it without letting people know. And I think what we found was pretty shocking, to say the least. So
it is. I mean, among the most shocking aspects is that even the most educated consumer niche, people who shop at Whole Foods,
you would think,
many of them didn't even know what genetically modified foods were, or much less any of their dangers, even though they've just had the rat study come out linking GM corn to tumors in those rats. We've seen Monsanto try to spin and play tiddlywinks with that report and try to downplay it. But it's a very real report that just echoes mountains of other research, pretty much any research that comes out of anywhere other than the biotech industry.
Exactly. And I mean, you'll see this, guys, in a minute. But when we did actually finally get some Whole Foods employees on camera, they had a lot of excuses and not a lot of answers. So I don't want to give too much away before we show the report.
Yeah, we want people to see the full report, but Alex and I were talking about this earlier. This is a classic case of false advertising. We show on the website, you can read the story, Whole Foods caught in false advertising scandal. We have a still of one of the Whole Foods locations here in Austin. They've got a big, proud, boastful banner on the side of their wall, a big mural that says, "Nothing artificial ever," and yet, this week, they've admitted in a press release, finally, they've been forced to admit that they do sell products that contain GMO ingredients. All the while, they're marketing to trendy people, to people with more money, that they could shop there and find organics when other stuff is on the shelf as well. People go there for the organics, but they're baited and switched by deals they see on the shelf. Not everybody has time to read ingredients. And furthermore, we've seen a whole movement where foods are labeled, quote, natural. Sounds organic, sounds wholesome, sounds healthy, but it actually is a term that can disguise genetically modified foods produced from Monsanto, you name it. That's why so many people want to see these labeling laws. And so again, the studies that Monsanto has conducted, the other biotech firms, were typically short-term studies, 3 months or less. This was the first majorly funded, peer-reviewed. This scientist had hundreds of awards, letters of recognition, where he did a long-term study throughout the entire life of the rats. It could compare the control group of non-GMO with the GMO-fed rats, and they grew tumors starting in the fourth month of life. And some of the other rats not eating GMOs also got cancer, but not in the same time span. This is a very dangerous product. It's out on the market. Nobody knows what it is, where it is, what's in it, and it's not labeled, people. It's a huge deception, and you better wake up to it before it's too late. All of humanity is at stake. I can't emphasize that enough, but without further ado, I take you now to that special report that myself and Melissa Melton filed earlier today.
I'm Melissa Melton. Melton reporting for Infowars Nightly News. We're here at a Whole Foods grocery store where we're trying to find out if people know about genetically modified food, about the dangers of that, and if they realize that Whole Foods is actually selling unlabeled genetically modified foods here at the store.
Do you mind if I ask you a few questions?
You know, I don't have time.
Oh, okay.
I don't really even know what GMO is, to be honest with you.
Have you ever heard of genetically modified food?
Not much.
GMO, have you heard of that?
I've heard of that regarding corn.
Have you heard of GMO?
Absolutely.
Are you concerned about it?
Absolutely.
Do you support the labeling initiative?
Absolutely.
Would you be surprised if I told you that Whole Foods is selling unlabeled genetically modified organisms?
Yes.
Aaron Dykes here for Infowars.com. We're here to talk to members of the public today to find out if they're aware of GMO dangers and if they know what's inside this Whole Foods store. We have their latest press release, which admits that they do sell ingredients that include genetically modified foods. Have you heard about the recent study where they fed GM corn to rats and they developed tumors?
Yes, I have.
Are you shopping here partly to avoid genetically modified foods?
Yes. Yes.
I haven't had a problem with genetically modified foods, and no, that wouldn't be why I was coming to Whole Foods.
So now, do they sell it or they don't sell it?
This Whole Foods truck says, what's cooking? And unfortunately, to the dismay of most people, according to this press release they just put out, it's GMO, genetically modified organisms. Do you know what you're eating? Were you aware that Whole Foods actually sells unlabeled GMOs?
I was not.
And we're surprised about that?
I think a lot of people probably are. Are you familiar with genetically modified food?
Well, I've heard of it.
Have you heard they've done studies recently that have shown that rats that are fed exclusive diets of genetically modified food actually get cancer, get tumors?
That makes sense. You go messing around with nature, some weird things are going to happen. That's probably just the beginning of it.
Probably. Do you ever shop at Whole Foods?
You mean Whole Paycheck?
Do you ever shop at Whole Foods here?
Yeah, I work there.
Are you familiar that Whole Foods put out a press release saying there's genetically modified organisms being sold in the store?
No, I wasn't aware of that.
While talking to the public, we were unknowingly approached by Whole Foods media relations spokesperson, Libba Letton.
And as an employee of Whole Foods, do you find it concerning that Whole Foods has admitted in their press release that they're selling unlabeled genetically modified organisms?
No, I think that unless a store is all organic, every store in the country sells unlabeled genetically modified.
Well, do you think that it's fair to say that most people who come here come in search of organic Whole Foods and they think that what they're buying is probably not genetically modified, and so to have unlabeled GMO is kind of against that whole advertisement?
I don't know what people think. I think they come here for organic food. I think they come here for healthy food. And again, I think the issue of people not knowing how pervasive GMOs are is a problem. But I don't think that Whole Foods does anything to try and make people think that we don't have food with GMOs in them.
You don't?
You see behind me, they have the slogan on this new store location, nothing artificial ever. However, that's not the case, which is why we also have to now put the spotlight on Whole Foods.
Now I think we're very clear about marking which foods are non-GMO.
Only later did we discover in research that Libba also represented Whole Foods investor relations and food safety.
90% of the corn and canola and cottonseed and soy in this country is actually genetically modified through companies like Monsanto and DuPont. And the derivatives of that are put into the food. And Whole Foods, you know, they market themselves as a whole food organization, and yet a lot of the stuff in here has unlabeled genetically modified. So
where would you get food that's, where would you buy the food that's not genetically organized?
Well, that's the question.
Would it be surprising to you to find out that Whole Foods also sells GMOs?
You know, I'm aware of that.
If I have the facts and if they're labeled, then that's fair, I'm educated. If they're not labeled, then I'm concerned. GMOs are one of the banes of our society right now, of our globe.
Well, I'm not really opposed to it. I mean, I think that most genetically modified food out there is actually safe and tested. A lot of it's going under FDA review. As long as the science is sound, I'm okay with it.
What does the FDA say about this?
Well, the FDA is kind of hard to gauge because Obama put Michael Taylor in, who was actually a Monsanto lobbyist for years and years, and now he's the food safety czar, so.
Well, isn't that politics as usual, huh?
If it is linked to cancer, I'd certainly like to know about it and stay away from it.
We don't know if it's genetically modified unless we test it.
Is there any plans to maybe do some testing?
To test every product in the store and see if there's GMOs in them?
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be easier to try and get some sort of federal requirement that all foods with GMOs have a label on them?
Here we go. Are you rolling?
Hi, folks, how are you?
Yep, we're just asking people what they think about genetically modified organisms and Proposition 37. And
okay. Just make sure we're 3 feet from the curb at all times.
Okay. We're on the public sidewalk here, aren't we?
3 feet from the curb is public sidewalk. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Okay?
Pretty sure I am 3 feet from the curb. Am I not? Do you have a ruler?
Actually, I can go get one if I need to.
I think they're standing over there having a little meeting about how they would really like to kick us off this public sidewalk that we have a First Amendment right to be on right now. And they can stand there all day with their badge and the little walkie-talkie and make as many phone calls as they want, but legally we have every right to be here. Just like I think as consumers we have every right to know whether or not we're eating genetically modified Frankenfood science projects when we feed ourselves and our children, and when we go to a store that labels themselves as organic but then turns around and sells us GMO.
Talk to them, but you can't just be out in front of the store.
Well, can we talk to those people?
Yeah, let's call them.
Okay.
Well, and maybe what I should do is call the shopping center.
Okay.
It's really up to them. I mean, this is their private space. This is not a public space. This is a private property owned by the shopping center.
But not by Whole Foods.
No, not this one, no.
We're just concerned to find out they also sell GMOs, so.
Actually, GMOs are in almost everything. Like, it would be really hard to find completely non-GMO anything. Uh-huh. And so, I mean, I don't think there's ever been... Like, we've never claimed that we don't sell GMOs.
There's a truck from Whole Foods coming this way, and it actually says 100% real ingredients. I just think that's really ironic because I don't think genetically modified and real are synonymous in any possible way. I mean, a unicorn Pegasus is real because I wrote about it in a book, but is it real? Something I created in a lab? It's a genetically modified Frankenfood science experiment. That's not real, and it's not food, at least it shouldn't be. Whole Foods was like one of the last large bastions of organic food, whole food, safe food. And that's why I think most consumers shop here. And then to quietly admit in a press release that isn't posted anywhere in the store, you have to go and search for it on their website to get it, that, oh yes, our food does contain genetically modified organisms, is just hypocritical to the nth degree, and it's dishonest and it's wrong. Do you think that maybe Whole Foods might consider supporting Proposition 37 financially?
We support Proposition 37 in a number of ways. You know, you can look at it that Whole Foods hasn't written a check to that yet.
Well, are you familiar with the fact that some of the higher-ups in Whole Foods have written a check to Christy Vilsack, Tom Vilsack's wife, who's the head of the USDA that's pretty much in bed with Monsanto?
Out of their personal bank accounts and not on behalf of Whole Foods Market, they can do whatever.
It's listed as Whole Foods Market, though.
Whole Foods Market to, well, I'm not aware of any of those.
He's also financially bankrolling Obama, who put, you know, Michael Taylor, who's a FDA food safety czar, and that guy's been a Monsanto lobbyist for years.
What about the donations to Gary Johnson?
I don't think it's like tit for tat, one good donation, one evil donation. I mean, that doesn't make any sense.
Only the bad ones matter.
It sends the wrong message, don't you think?
No, I think our actions send the message. I think private donations made by executives sends messages from them personally about what they're doing.
So what's all the fuss about Whole Foods and GMO? Well, it seems the bigwigs over there got pretty chummy with the USDA when they were hammering out the deal over Monsanto's deregulation of GE alfalfa. Now, Walter Robb from Whole Foods is donating to Christy Vilsack, the wife of Tom Vilsack, who heads the USDA department. Tom Vilsack bent over backwards for cloning, pushed GMOs into the mainstream, opened all the doors for Big Agra, and even stood up for the open-air experimentation of GMOs that had biopharmaceuticals blowing in the wind. Then Obama appointed Tom Vilsack to be Secretary of Agriculture so he could help fast-track GMOs big time. Now Tom Vilsack's wife, Christy, is running for Congress there. But don't worry, her opponent, Steve King, is also bought out by Big Agra and the biotech industry. The only question is, why would Walter Robb or any organic industry executive want to cut checks to the wife of someone who's fought Monsanto's fight every step of the way and done nothing but deceive the organic industry about regulating GMOs?
Well, what's really kind of troubling about Whole Foods also is that while they won't back Proposition 37 financially, some of their higher ups have financially backed and donated to the political campaigns of people like Obama, who put in Michael Taylor as our food safety czar, who was a Monsanto lobbyist for years. He's now the FDA food safety czar. You've got them financially backing Tom Vilsack's wife, and he's the USDA Secretary of Agriculture, who's totally in bed with Monsanto. So it's like, you won't give money to Proposition 37, but some of your higher ups are personally giving money to people they should be 100% against.
So I completely agree with that. I mean, they're all corrupt.
It's disappointing.
They're really big business, and they're getting bigger all the time. And Mackey has a pretty good history of not straight dealing. So,
Mr. Mackey, I would tell him to go straight south.
As we try to protect ourselves through organic food and avoid GMOs, are we making Whole Foods a sacred cow, hoping they're an ally for our cause of eating natural, wholesome, organic foods, when in fact their leadership has sold out to the USDA, has met at the table with Monsanto, and has compromised with them, and in fact stocked GMOs on their shelf?
The science is in. The recent GMO study on rats serves as a stark reminder that what we don't know can hurt us. And duping an already uninformed public is just plain dangerous and evil.
While we agree that labeling non-GMO is a start, it simply does not follow that Whole Foods knowingly selling GMO products without at least warning the public, not just with some quiet press release, but with actual signage on store shelves, is wrong. Waiting for bought and paid for politicians to fix the problem is nothing short of leaving customers to fend for themselves against a clear and present danger while raking in the profits. For InfoWars Nightly News, I'm Melissa Melton.
And I'm Aaron Dykes.
So that is the video report. I hope you spread it everywhere to the four winds. I hope you share it with people you know. I hope you share it with people you don't know, because it's such an important topic, all the more so because it's confusing, because it's difficult to navigate, because there's a lot of back-channel deals going on. We showed you many of the campaign donations. We traced the political links between the so-called big organic elites, people at Whole Foods, Stonyfield Farms, other companies who are donating to the USDA after they've had a track record of repeatedly time and again backing Monsanto. What does that tell you? Why else would they fund those entities if something bigger wasn't going on? It's just like the Rockefellers always said, that competition is a sin. That's why you see almost cartel-like activity. But that's just one level of the deception. On the other level, you've got some people aware of the GMO issue, seeking out organics, going to Whole Foods because they provide more organic foods than anyone else in the retail sector. But then you're still exposed to GMOs, even though you're paying a premium price and the company's making billions and billions and their stock goes up and up. Meanwhile, poor people, working families, middle-class families with more than one person in the house could barely afford to shop at Whole Foods, even if they're educated about GMOs, the fact that they're dangerous, the fact that they've been linked to cancer, infertility, and more in studies. This is coming down on humanity. They've not been informed. The public has not been told. We talk to people on the streets, even at Whole Foods, the most expensive grocery store with the most educated people in town. Most people didn't even know what GMOs were. What do you think it's like at the cheaper grocery stores where they sell all that GMO garbage? It's a negative incentive against regular families. It's a new standard you have to lift yourself up to. You have to pay. You have to buy in to survive in this new era where Bill Gates and Rockefeller control what you eat, and there's all these back doors that cause problems. It's such an important and deceptive issue. I don't want to get more and more into it, but we covered last time how Mitt Romney was caught secretly eating organic, even though he backed Monsanto back in 1977 when he was at Bain Capital, helped get them on the market with biotechnology products. You see Barack Obama, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, all obsessed in their presidential terms with eating organic while telling the public it's okay to eat these GMO crops, that it's going to save Africa, that it's going to feed the world. Then you look at the backers behind that. Bill Gates travels with his own chefs, has his own private organic farms, even though he tells people to take vaccines and eat Monsanto's GMO junk. Rockefeller is completely in league with the same thing. He's built his own organic farms from scratch, people. That's how obsessed these people are. Ted Turner keeps his own bison herds and more. They do this at the upper levels, and you eat the crud and get sick and die. It's really nasty stuff. I don't want to rant on and on. Melissa, you fleshed out other points. We did a lot of research on this project.
It was a lot. One of the things I think that really bothered me was when Roulette and the media relations person came out and decided to talk to us. And
She kind of ambushed us.
She really didn't announce herself. She didn't announce herself at first, and she just kind of milled around on the sidewalk and kept shooting, you know, giving me
But that's good, though. I'm glad they came to talk to us.
She didn't say who she was. No, I'm glad they did, too. But she didn't say anything until after it was all over. She said, here's my card. But she opened with, you know, that GMO is just so pervasive, and people just don't really understand how pervasive it is. So there's nothing they can really do. I mean, that was kind of her excuse. And basically, she's just the company's resting on their laurels. They're waiting for this federal initiative to go through to force companies to label. Meanwhile, they're, I guess, not going to put anything on the shelves. You saw me ask her about that. And they're reaping the profits on this false advertising of nothing artificial ever. So there's nothing artificial ever, and yet she's talking about how pervasive GMO is.
But wait, that's a big part of the hypocrisy, because we've seen Monsanto and the other companies suing states not to have labeling bills, and now here's this big Prop 37 in California, has a good likelihood to pass. There's so many concerned people in California about food and environmental issues. It's a big rally point. And here's Whole Foods, supposed to be the industry leader. They're not backing it financially. They've been real flaky. And tell them more. Who are the companies?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, they're selling all kinds of products from companies that are financially backing the opposition to Prop 37. For example, Naked Juice, they sell Naked Juice at Whole Foods. And Naked Juice is a PepsiCo product. PepsiCo has given almost $2 million towards the opposition to Proposition 37. It's the most of any company outside of
Monsanto
and DuPont.
They've anteed up with Monsanto and DuPont.
Exactly. Only Monsanto and DuPont have given more than PepsiCo.
Because they use that the corn-based sugars that are all genetically modified.
Exactly. And so by Whole Foods selling that, they're actually helping to bankroll the opposition to Proposition 37, not financially supporting it in any way. And then meanwhile, as we saw in our research, you've got CEOs financially bankrolling people like Tom Vilsack's wife.
Right.
I mean, that's pretty scary, especially since she's gone on record to say pink slime is healthy for us all. We should all just get a heaping plate of that.
And that's Walter Robb. He's a big Democrat. Fine if you want to donate to Obama, even though I don't know how you could do that when
but
you know so much about the industry.
But to give $1 to Christy Vilsack.
Yeah.
Even 5 cents to her.
But he's from California. He gives to California candidates. Why is he giving
this
to Vilsack in Iowa?
Yeah, this is Iowa.
Yeah,
it doesn't make any sense. And she said, but that's what they do personally. That's their personal action, so that doesn't count. But it's the CEO, it's the co-CEO of Whole Foods.
But the
it
bottom line
count.
Is, they made the argument in the Organic Spies video that that Whole Foods would not benefit if the labeling law passed, because they would have to relabel all their food, renegotiate all their contracts, because they sell so many, quote, natural foods and unlabeled derivative foods on their shelves. They do sell a lot of organic, but there's so much else at their store, too. They would be financially hurt by that.
Well, you know, I think putting it off on the consumer is really bad also. Just to have that excuse that it's all, that people need to educate themselves on how pervasive GMO is. And it's like, but I asked her, I said, are you guys going to put any kind of labels up? Well, we couldn't do that. They can't put a sign on the shelf. I mean, they can't even say, hey, there may be GMOs here. I mean, that's the least they could do. And then I said, well, are you going to do any testing? She said, you expect me to test everything in the store? Yeah, if you're going to charge me $8 for a balsamic vinaigrette, then yeah, you can afford to test the things on your shelves and make sure they're healthy for people to eat.
Well, it's this whole bait and switch, because everybody basically knows the regulatory agencies, the FDA, the USDA, have been bought out. They put Monsanto people in at those positions. In the case of Michael Taylor, they created a new position for food safety czar so he could write the policies over decades.
Yes,
and
the Monsanto
go through
lobbyist
the revolving
is the food
door.
Safety czar. That makes
and he was
total
a lawyer
sense.
And a vice president for Monsanto. And Vilsack's the
safe.
Same way.
Yeah. I feel like that food's pretty safe.
But that's the grand deception, is that we don't know who to turn to. So people are looking for a leader. That's why so many consumers have invested in Whole Foods over the years, because they seem like they were doing the right thing. But people aren't going to support them if that continues. I know Mike Adams has covered a whole string of companies that for 10, 20 years would be all organic, totally natural, very responsible with where they get their different sources, vitamin companies, food products, you name it. But then they get bought out by the big food conglomerates, and it all goes bad, and people stop supporting those companies. But there's all these deceptive layers of which company is which and the friendly sounding name. It makes it hard to keep up. It's a real burden on a consumer who wants to stay healthy.
Well, you heard Ms. Letton say it. You know, every grocery store in America has GMO. It's everywhere. And by saying that, in a way, she's also saying that Whole Foods is just like every other grocery store everywhere. It's not special.
But people don't support Whole Foods to be just like every other grocery store. They support them because they think it's a bastion of health, and it just isn't. I just really hope people will watch this report, will tell other people about it, because it's such a critical report.
It's huge.
We put a lot of effort into it. We both stayed up all night working on it.
Yeah, we've
been researching all week. We've been talking with Alex and Du and the other people who know about this issue. We've been watching these videos, consulting with Mike Adams. A lot went into this, people, and there's going to be more, too. We're going to continue to cover this. So I hope Whole Foods will back out of their part of the deception. We know who your leadership is donating money to. We know what's going on behind the scenes. We're going to keep an eye on you, and we're not going to buy your garbage products if you're going to keep selling them, especially if you put giant murals about nothing artificial ever on the side of your wall when you sell GMOs, admittedly, in your own press release. I'm disgusted. By the way, I hope you'll go to prisonplanet.tv. Consider getting a membership. You can share it with five other people. That's six people for the price of one. You can give information. You can download all these video files. All the nightly news shows, all of Alex's radio shows, special reports. You can create your own info libraries, and you can send the links out to people, get them aware of the issues. Meanwhile, you can go to planetinfowars.com and use it as a printing press, as an outlet for your point of view on how best to fight the New World Order, which issues are most important. Network with people you know and start the resistance now. Do not wait. And that's all for tonight's Infowars Nightly News. We'll be back next week on Monday with more powerful, hard-hitting reports. Thanks for watching. Thanks for tuning in. And please spread the words. We've got to stop these GMOs. It's going to be too late, people.